I would like to thank the organizer of the Congress to have invited us to present our data about thyroid autoimmune disorders. There is a wide spectrum of autoimmune thyroid disorders. The most important are Hashimoto's thyroiditis, that is a non-tender film goiter associated with normal thyroid function or hypothyroidism, and the presence of antithyroglobulin autoantibodies or antithyroperoxidase antibodies, and Graves' disease, that is associated with a diffuse goiter, hyperthyroidism, and the presence of pathogenic anti-TSH receptor autoantibodies. There is a wide variability in the incidence and prevalence of thyroid autoimmune disorders. You can see here that the incidence of autoimmune hypothyroidism range from 27 cases per 100,000 people per year in Spain to 448 in Scotland. And this variability is present also for Graves' disease, from 21 in Sweden to 120 in northern China. This wide variability is due to genetic susceptibility and also to different environmental risk factors. About genetic susceptibility, the first study were case control studies and then SNP case control studies, but more recently, genome-wide association studies have shown that many genes are associated with the susceptibility to autoimmune thyroid disorders. Among genes whose functions are known, PTPN22 is involved in T cell transduction. CTLA-4 plays a role in inhibiting T cell signaling. HLA class 2 region play a key part in presenting endogenous antigens to recognition CD4 T helper cells. IL-2 array is expressed on T regulatory cells. FCRL3 is expressed on B cell maturation. HLA class 1 region play a key role in presenting endogenous antigens such as virally derived antigens for recognition by CD8 T cells. TSH receptor is the primary autoantigen for Graves' disease. CGFP14 has been shown to be expressed in CD4 T helper and CD8 T cells. BACH2 is expressed during B cell maturation. RNA-SET2 is expressed on CD4 T helper cells. And FOSQ1 is involved in thyroid gland morphogenesis. There are other genes, but their functions is currently unknown. Among these 11 genes that are involved in the susceptibility to thyroid autoimmune disorders, 8 are involved with the function of T lymphocytes. Suggesting the importance of T lymphocytes in the pathogenesis of thyroid autoimmune disorders. Thyroid autoimmune disorders are organ-specific autoimmune disease and are associated with a preponderance of a Th1 immune response, where Th1 lymphocytes produce the main Th1 cytokines, interleukin-2, but overall interferon gamma, that induce the immune response. Interferon gamma act through chemokines that are small molecules that are involved in lymphoid organ development, Th1-Th2 differentiation, leukocyte trafficking, angiogenesis, cell recruitment, and inflammation. There are 4 different subfamily of these chemokines. Among them, 3, CXCL9, 10, and 11, binds to the same receptor, the CXCR3 receptor, that is present on lymphocytes, immunocompetent cells, and also on epithelial cells. These 3 chemokines are called as interferon gamma inducible chemokines because they can be induced in epithelial cells by interferon gamma. Here you can see that we have shown that primary human thyrocytes are not able to produce these 6L10 chemokines basally, but interferon gamma is able to induce the expression of this chemokine in a dose-dependent way. TNF-alpha alone has no effect, while the combination of interferon gamma plus TNF-alpha induce a huge release of this chemokine. And the same is true also for CXCL11 and for CXCL9. You can see here that interferon gamma and TNF-alpha are able to induce a huge release of CXCL9 from primary thyrocytes. But this is true also for other kinds of cells, for example, fibroblasts and pre-adipocytes obtained from the retroorbital tissue of patients with Graves' ophthalmopathy. Chemokines produced into the thyroid and into the orbits enter into the circulation. And chemokine levels in circulation are high. You can see that 6L9 serum levels in patients with thyroiditis is higher than controls or multinodular goiter patients, overall in presence of hypothyroidism, suggesting that is related to the aggressive of the inflammation. And a similar trend was observed also for the other chemokine 6L11. In Graves' disease, the circulating levels of interferon gamma-inducible chemokines is higher than in controls, toxic multinodular goiter, and autoimmune thyroiditis. Serum levels decrease with metimazole therapy and normalize after thyroidectomy, showing that the chemokines are produced into the thyroid. These studies and many other studies have shown that the cytokine-chemokine pattern in Hashimoto's thyroiditis shows a prevalence of the Th1 immune response. In Graves' disease, a prevalence of the Th1 immune response has been shown in the active phase of the disease, while in the inactive phase, a Th2 prevalence is suggested. And the same is true also for Graves' ophthalmopathy. In the active stage, there is a prevalence of the Th1 immune response that shift to a Th2 immune response in the inactive Graves' ophthalmopathy. And in fact, the CXCL10 chemokine that you cannot see because it's there is higher in patients with active Graves' ophthalmopathy than in patients with inactive Graves' ophthalmopathy. These slides were done with a Mac, and there are a few problems. We have recently shown that 6L10 is produced also by extraocular muscle cells from patients with extraocular with Graves' ophthalmopathy under the stimulation of interferon gamma. And in this recent study, these authors evaluated 10 different cytokines and chemokines in patients treated with intravenous glucocorticosteroids. And they found that the only chemokine that was significantly reduced but intravenous administration was CXCL10. And a similar finding was observed in this study from the group of Poland. They studied 6L9 and 10 in patients treated with Graves' orbitopathy, treated with corticosteroid and teleradiotherapy. And you can see that 6L9 is decreasing, such as CXCL10. And we have recently shown here that the three chemokines are normalized after the intravenous corticosteroid treatment in responder patients, but not in not responders, suggesting that they may be useful in monitoring the effect of glucocorticosteroid treatment in this patient. Environment is very important in the development of autoimmune thyroid disorders. Stress is related to Graves' disease. Smoking is related to Graves' disease and especially to Graves' ophthalmopathy. But it protects against autoimmune hypothyroidism. Iodine excess is related with both autoimmune hypothyroidism and Graves' disease. Selenium deficiency is related with autoimmune hypothyroidism, and irradiation, lithium, and immunomodulation are related with both autoimmune hypothyroidism and Graves' disease. There are many studies that have evaluated the importance of viral infection in the induction of Hashimoto's thyroiditis or even Graves' disease, with no significant results. But more recently, we have shown that hepatitis C chronic infection is associated with autothyroid autoimmune disorders. In this study, we have shown that the prevalence of hypothyroidism in patients treated with chronic hepatitis C is 30% and is higher than control subject from a iodine deficient area, 3%, control subject from a iodine sufficient area, 5%, and patient with chronic hepatitis B infection. So we hypothesized that the hepatitis C virus enter into the thyrocytes, inducing the production of the interferon gamma-dependent chemokines that recruit Th1 lymphocytes into the thyroid, that produce interferon gamma and TNF-alpha, that produce a further increase of these chemokines, initiating and perpetuating the autoimmune process. In fact, in the circulation of patients with hepatitis C chronic infection and thyroiditis, these chemokines are higher than in patients without thyroiditis. The presence of the hepatitis C virus has been shown in the thyroid tissue and in thyroid cells. And more recently, a human thyroid cell line ML1 could be infected by hepatitis C virus in vitro. So we hypothesized that HCV infection of thyrocytes induces CXCL10 secretion by thyrocytes with recruitment of Th1 lymphocytes and thyrocyte damage and activation of autoantibodies production with persistence of autoimmunity. In fact, when we have infected the primary human thyrocytes with HCV virus and treated them with interferon gamma and TNF-alpha, we show a huge release of chemokines with respect to thyrocytes not infected by hepatitis C virus. It's well known that there is an association between thyroid autoimmunity and systemic autoimmune disorders. The base of this association is a common genetic predisposition. Here you can see that Sjögren's syndrome is associated with clinical and subclinical hypothyroidism and with the genetic participation of HLB8 and DR3. And the same is true also for lupus, rheumatoid arthritis, and for scleroderma. We have been done studies in large number of patients with lupus showing a high prevalence of thyroid autoimmune disorders. And for the first time, we have shown that in patients with thyroid autoimmunity and lupus, there is a high prevalence of thyroid cancer, of papillary thyroid cancer. And this is the first longitudinal study that evaluated the incidence of thyroid disorders in patients with systemic autoimmune disorders. And in systemic sclerosis, we have shown a high incidence of thyroid autoimmune disorders, such as autoimmune thyroiditis, hypothyroidism, and Graves' disease. But which is the common immunopathogenetic relation? In our opinion, the common pathogenetic relation is a Th1 immune prevalence. And for example, we have evaluated the two chemokines, CXCL10, that is the Th1 prototype chemokine, and CCL2, that is the Th2 prototype chemokine, in patients with systemic sclerosis without autoimmune thyroiditis or with thyroiditis. And you can see that CXCL10, but also the other chemokines, are higher in the circulation of patients with systemic sclerosis and thyroiditis than those without thyroiditis, while CCL2 is not different. And these and other studies suggest that a immune preponderance of the Th1 immune response is the immunopathogenetic basis of this association. So we have proposed that in many autoimmune diseases, Th1 cells produce interferon gamma and TNF-alpha, inducing in different cells, such as beta cells, thyrocytes, fibroblasts, pre-adipocytes, endothelial cells, and glomerular cells, but many other. These chemokines, interferon gamma-inducible chemokines, that recruit other Th1 lymphocytes in the inflamed tissue, inducing initiating and perpetuating the immune process. On this basis, many studies have evaluated drugs that are able to block CXCL10 or its receptor, CXCR3. Here, there is a randomized double-blind placebo-controlled study evaluating the efficacy and safety of a few human CXCL10 monoclonal antibodies in patients with rheumatoid arthritis. And the results were very impressive because these were patients resistant to the common therapy with rheumatoid arthritis. In this other paper, a selective and potent CXCR3 antagonist attenuates the development of autoimmune diseases and delays graft rejection. So, in conclusion, genome-wide association studies have shown that genetic susceptibility to autoimmune thyroid disease is associated mostly with genes related to T lymphocyte function. Environmental factors such as smoking, iodine, selenium deficiency, and also viruses such as hepatitis C virus are associated with autoimmune thyroid disorders. And immunological studies have shown that the cytokine-chemokine pattern in Hashimoto's thyroiditis shows a prevalence of the Th1 immune response. In Graves' disease and Graves' ophthalmopathy, a prevalence of the Th1 immune response has been shown in the early active phase, while in the inactive phase there is a Th2 prevalence. The cytokine-chemokine pattern in autoimmune thyroid disorder shows a prevalence of the Th1 immune response also in patients with systemic autoimmunity. And studies are evaluating drugs that are able to block Th1 chemokine CXCL10 or the receptor CXCR3 in autoimmune diseases. Thank you for your attention.